Has anyone finished yet? Can someone show me anything? Eyes? Yeah. Very nice. Ah, yes. Yeah, I can see that in the back too. Well, and again, oh, it's just as in the Netherlands. I made this one. I added a bit of color and a tree, but this is what more than 75, perhaps even more than 80% of the people would draw when they are asked to draw a house. So, now what does this little experiment tell us? It tells us that we do have a kind of prototype idea, a kind of concept what a house would generally look like. This is what children draw, and what many of you will draw within a few seconds as well. When I walk in a big city in Amsterdam, and people living in Amsterdam, who live in apartment buildings, you know, five stories high, they will still draw something like this. So yes, this is the prototype of our house. We all have an idea about home. Perhaps people with dementia have that same idea. Then I ask you, why do we move people with dementia to a nursing home that would look like this? It took me about 50 seconds on the internet to find a number of pictures and photographs of nursing homes in the Netherlands. And this is what you come up with. An interior photographs. Beautiful. Or this. Really. Design. Furniture. Or an entrance of a home for the elderly like this. Is it strange that when people move to a nursing home designed like this, perhaps even designed beautifully with interior architects and what have you not, are lost? It does not resemble home. It resembles more a building like a university like this. When I entered here this morning, Christian told me where the toilet facility was, where I can wash my hands. Because otherwise I would have to look around. In nursing homes, when I visit nursing homes, the same thing happens to me there. I have to find my way. It is not logical. When I enter a home in Holland, and probably here in Germany as well, no one will have to tell me where the toilet is. It's generally close to the front door in the hall, somewhere situation, and I can find it by myself. So, why do we help people, or try to help people, by bringing them to an environment and those people are disoriented? They have trouble getting around and finding their way. And then we bring them to a place where even we, who are not damaged by dementia, will have trouble finding our way. With that in mind, and that's actually my first serious, I've met people with dementia before, but over 25 years ago I started working with people with dementia as a nurse. And I did this, what we were in a facility that we would call now group living for people with dementia, or small scale living for people with dementia, group homes. The Anton Pieckhoffje in Haarlem, one of the first in Holland, and now there are many more like it. Now what happened there? We realized, and the colleagues of the nursing home who actually initiated this project, realized that we see a lot of what we call, with a fancy word, access disabilities in people with dementia. The first time, from the traditional nursing home, we would take people on a holiday once a year for a week. Just a simple holiday home, and then there was no central kitchen, there was nothing like that. So we all had to organize our meals. And, you know, it was perhaps not all that well suited, but we all got by very well. And suddenly, people started peeling potatoes and taking pots away from the nurses and said, let me do that, I can do that better than you. So, if you challenge people and if you elicit behavior, they probably will show it. So we started, out of the blue, finding six people and put them together or made them move to a new home, a house with its own front door. Everybody had a private bedroom and they shared the living and the kitchen and the shower and the bathroom. A simple, not very large, not big. It was all furnished with the things that people brought along from home. Someone had a good dining table, so they brought the dining table with chairs. And most people still have a very comfortable chair that they'd like to sit in the evening. So bring your own chair, bring your own bed, bring your own wardrobe. As long as it's functional, as long as you can use it and can get in and out of bed yourself, why not sleep in your own bed? Why in a hospital bed? And we started to organize just the ordinary household. People getting up, 8, 9 in the morning. They were over 80 years old, so they did not have to go to work, so there's nothing waiting for them. So they would sleep in. They didn't get up all that early. And then, well, when you get up, you wash, you dress, you get assistance if you need it. There's always a nurse present, of course, because it is about people with dementia. There's seriously something wrong with them. And they are in need of assistance. And then you might drink coffee in the morning, after breakfast, prepare for lunch. You might be actually discussing what we're going to have for dinner tonight. It's not just being brought to you, no. You are asked, what would you like? And if you talk about preparing food, you could relate to, yes, I used to make that often. I like that. My husband liked it, for instance. I like to cook that. So the day takes a natural rhythm and a natural course. You have lunch, and after lunch, you might take a nap. I would, if I can have a chance. I'd love to sleep for a short while in the afternoon. And then, of course, preparing dinner. So, getting, and in the meantime during the day, doing household chores like laundry. Everything is done within the home. Cleaning, vacuuming, whatever. Not that all the people do it themselves, but they may participate. They even, participation could also mean telling you, don't peel those potatoes that way. You take far too thick slices of the skin. Or they can tell you how they used to fry the meatballs or the sausages. And when you start cooking late afternoon, it starts smelling because the kitchen is just like in all households, very close to the living room. And when you start smelling food, you get an appetite. You would like to eat. In the traditional nursing home, where we provide meals for people from a central kitchen, in Holland, most of the times those warm meals, those main courses of the day, are had at noon. If you're lucky, at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, lunch hour. That dates back from the days when most of us were farmers and we needed a solid meal after the morning of hard work. Nowadays, nobody eats a hot meal during lunch. But when you make a hot meal during lunch and present it, well, start timing. Breakfast, at latest, should be finished by 10, preferably earlier. So you can have coffee between breakfast and your main course. So what happens is that we start very early in the nursing homes. 7 o'clock, ding dong. We all rush around, have a lot of, most focus of the staff, and the highest presence of staff is in the mornings. And they start working very hard. And they do, it's hard work, trying to get everybody out of bed in time. And then, finally, it's all done, 10 o'clock, yes, we made it. Coffee, whew. Sit down and relax. And then, okay, doing the rest of the chores and preparing the meal, laying the tables, make sure that the cars with all the food are getting brought to the ward in time. And then we try and get all people at the table, and then suddenly the food is there. And what happens? No one's eating. It's simply, I often said that actually the main manager of a traditional nursing home is not the managing director, it's the cook. Because he dictates everything that happens clockwise. The whole schedule throughout the day. So if you start using your common sense and just ask, why do we do that? Why can we not provide a meal in the evening and cook it ourselves and just do the things that you'd like to do at home? And that sums up a bit of what would you call just living as it is at home. What do you do in the evening after you've eaten? In Holland we have a cup of coffee or tea. You might watch the news or telly or a show on television. You might read a newspaper or talk about things and maybe do a board game or something like that. And then at some stage you go to bed. When I started working in the Anderbeekhofje, there was no one going to bed before 9 o'clock. Most of the time, I would start at, say, 10. And it's an easy job to assist 6 people when they feel tired and getting tired to help them to bed at night. In the traditional nursing home, because there's so much focus on all morning activities, there are few nurses who have to do all the work in the evening. And what you see is that there's one nurse on something like 20 people for a night shift, for an evening shift, and she will have to bring all those 20 people to bed. And she might start at 7. If you put me to bed at 7 o'clock in the evening, perhaps I'd fall asleep. And if I'd fall asleep, I would wake up at about 2 or 3 in the night, right back. And then someone would call that nocturnal unrest or nocturnal disturbance. And we have to find ways to deal with that. When people are guided to live more through a daily routine, an ordinary life, just like you and me, most of them will sleep through the night. And they get up in the morning. So a lot of problems we call upon ourselves with all good intentions, by not doing the right things. And daily activities, do we have to provide special activities? No, it's a lot of daily activities keep people busy. My mother is 80 years old, she's still healthy, but after a special day in her life, she needs a few days to take it easy and calm, and she will do just this. Get up, wash, dress, breakfast, bit of lunch, take a nap in the afternoon, watch some telly in the evening, and she's happy.